Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you're watching on this fine planet. My name is Rina, and with me I've got Neo, yes, the one.
How you doing,
hello.
Rina?
Hello, how are you, sir?
Okay, yourself?
How's life?
Good, good. So you seek me out? You want to
yes.
know if what you found could be some help?
I've come across some interesting dates here I'm sure you'll be interested in.
Right.
The first being Mr. Williams Hole and when it was made.
Right. Mr. Williams Hole, right?
Yeah.
And that was a hole in his apartment, right? When he was arrested, the cops got into his apartment. There was a big hole there. And he had some writing on the walls, which we'll see in a little bit. And when Maury investigated, he claimed that it was a hole in the park. But when I did some groundwork, I realized that there was no Mr. Williams Hole, that nobody knew of that hung out in the park, and there was no such thing.
There was no hole in the ground.
Right. So I kind of then, you know, wondered, who is Mr. Williams then? So when the killer tapes came out, I noticed in the killer tapes that there was neighbors of Berkowitz that lived right next to him, not under him, not outside, right next to him, that were bothering him with noise. So I started to look up a lot of Williams families in Yonkers, and I came across a Lewis Williams, and he had a few children, and he was married to a woman named Edna. And that is how I found Edna was the lady that was giving reports. Lewis didn't give any, but Edna had gave a few reports, articles, and to reporters. So that is how I kind of figured that the Williams were living next door. He was talking about the family next door. Not a hole in the park or anything else but that.
No, you never hear about Mr. Williams. You always ever heard about Edna. You always saw Edna. Edna was always in the newspapers, but never Lewis. I'd never heard of Lewis's name until now.
Right. Well, Edna's the only one who gave any reports. Lewis didn't talk to anybody about what went on.
So we found these two obituaries here. Shall I read them out?
Yeah.
Okay. So we've got Edna E. Williams, homemaker. Edna E. Williams, a longtime Yonkers resident and homemaker, died of cancer Sunday at Calvary Hospital in the Bronx. She was 67. She was born February 10th, 1927 in Gettysburg, North Carolina, to David and Margaret Ivy Barnes. She moved to Yonkers when she was 11. On September 27th, 1952, she married Lewis Williams Jr. Miss Williams was a member of Mount Carmel Baptist Church in Yonkers. She is survived by her husband of Yonkers, her mother of Yonkers, four sons, Ernie and Zachary, Wayne and Tracy, all of Yonkers, three daughters, Brenda Greenbaum of Boca Raton, Florida, and Sandra Robbins and Lisa Williams, both of Yonkers, two brothers, Cornell Barnes of Hampton, Virginia, and David Barnes of Virginia Beach, Virginia, a sister, Ada Jones of Yonkers, 12 grandchildren and six great-grandchildren. A son, Eugene, died earlier. So that's Edna's obituary. And then you've got her husband, Lewis Williams Jr. He died after her. So Lewis Williams Jr., a retired molding machine operator and longtime Yonkers resident, died Saturday at Yonkers General Hospital. He was 65. Mr. Williams worked for Otis Elevator Company in Yonkers from 1953 until retiring in 1983. He was born November 20th, 1928 to Lewis Sr. and Lillian Stevenson Williams in Raleigh, North Carolina, where he grew up and attended schools. Mr. Williams had lived in Yonkers since 1945. On September 27th, 1952, he married Edna Barnes in Yonkers. He is survived by his wife, four sons, Ernest, Zachary, Wayne, and Tracy, all of Yonkers, three daughters, Brenda Greenbaum. These are the same names I went over a minute ago. His son, Eugene, and three brothers, Moses, Joseph, and Corinthian, all died earlier. So that's their obituaries. So they died in a short time of each other, basically.
Right. And that's the Williams family that was living next door to Berkowitz. Lewis and Edna, that were playing music that was bothering Berkowitz also. And if you want to pull up the first article here, we can see what Edna talks about.
So But once, about a month ago at 5 a.m., she heard a loud banging noise against the wall that divides their apartments. She said the next morning she got up and noticed a crack in the wall. I was afraid, but I never bothered to tell anyone, she said.
Right. So this article was given in August of 77, right after the arrest. I think it was a day or two after. Okay. And she's saying now that it happened a month ago. She heard this loud bang at around 5 a.m.
Mm-hmm. Next.
So that would be in July 77. Yep. She's saying she heard that loud bang. Go ahead.
So the next article, Edna Williams, who lives next door to Berkowitz, said her only contact with the young man was a loud one. She showed reporters a large crack in the living room wall and described how it got there. I was sleeping in the living room because it was during the heat wave in July and the air conditioner was there. I was awakened at 4 or 5 a.m. by a loud bang. The next morning, I saw the crack in the wall.
Okay, so you see here it says during the heat wave in July, right? Yeah. So we already know it's in July. She said it was a month earlier in the last one. Now she's saying the heat wave. So if you go back to 1977 in July, the heat wave was July 13th to the 20th. So now we have the month. And now we have about a week there. We can maybe now look at those days and see what day it is that he put the hole in the wall. Now, we also can take out July 13th and 14th because it was a blackout. Okay. And in this article, she says she was sleeping in her living room because that's where the air conditioner was. So if there was a blackout, she wouldn't have been able to use her air conditioner when it happened.
Exactly.
That it wasn't the 13th or 14th. So it was either somewhere between July 15th, okay, and the 20th of July.
And 17th. Wasn't there only one Saturday towards the end of this? You said something about there's only a Saturday.
Right, yeah, go to the next article.
So, the apartment's deep yellow shag rug was strewn with army fatigues, how-to books, and Bob Dylan records. Scrawled next to the fist-sized hole punched through the plaster wall, "My name is Mr. Williams, and I live in this hole." Hairline cracks now radiate from the bulge in the wall of his neighbor, Edna Williams, who said she rarely saw the night shift postal worker. She was awakened, she told reporters, by a bang at 4 a.m. one Saturday a few months ago. I thought he'd thrown something in anger. Aside from that, he was dormant.
Right. So you see in this article, she says Saturday, right? So during that July 77 heat wave, it was only one Saturday.
Yep.
From that 13th to the 20th. So that would mean that he put the hole in the wall in his apartment on Saturday, July 16th, 1977, just about a month before he was arrested.
And not 2 days before his arrest, like many have claimed.
Now, there's many rumors of people being in the apartment for the arrest, and it was immaculate. That's impossible. It was also rumors of Berkowitz messing his whole apartment up before his arrest to make him look insane. That is not what happened. That
hole was put in there amongst the Salvation Army.
I'm sorry?
Sending stuff to the Salvation Army.
Yeah, taking his furniture out. Yeah, there was a lot of stories of what happened, but that hole was put in a month before his arrest.
Yeah.
Right. And why don't you, you got a look at that wall, right? You got an article with the wall?
Yeah.
Well, that right there is William Herring's.
Now. Yeah.
The writing on the wall that he did, when he was arrested, there was a magazine, Crime Magazine it was called, November 1976 issue. It was in his apartment. Now, this killer was from Chicago, 1940s. He wrote on the walls of some victims of his. He also left a letter at one of his crime scenes like Berkowitz did. And Berkowitz has said, you know, he knew about Herring's and copycatted him a little bit, you know, his writing on the wall. And if you can look at the writing there, that's by Herring's. And that looks a little bit like the next picture.
Yeah, it looks like Berkowitz's writing.
Right.
I mean, the next one, is even more similar.
Right. That's Herring's on top. Yep. And that is Berkowitz on the bottom.
And they look very, very similar.
Right. He meant to make it look similar, yeah?
I mean, okay, I'll read out what it says just in case people can't see it. "Hi, my name is Mr. Williams, and I live in this hole. I have several children. I'm turning into killers. Wait till they grow up. And next to it, my neighbors, I have no respect for, and I treat them like shit. Sincerely, Williams. And that takes us back to the point earlier in the obituary. And they have several children between them, don't they?
Right. Right. Good point. Good point. I mean, there could have been a lot of activity with the kids there. Good point. Right.
And we know David was watching everybody around, neighbors, you know.
Right.
So, I mean, I'd never noticed it until now, until we looked at this. I'd right. never noticed like the correlation between, because I'd never seen Edna's obituary.
Makes sense. Right.
Yeah. Totally makes sense. And with the William Herons.
Right.
It's all coming together now. I've never even noticed before, like the children. And now we know they had seven children. Four sons, three daughters. And we know Berkowitz would have seen them coming and going.
Right.
So we know Edna was 50 around the time of 1977. Should have made her teenagers, yeah. you know, 15, 16, 17, their kids. We don't know their exact ages, but we can only surmise.
All right. I think you got that. I think that's what was meant on the wall. Right.
And our next little project is the Cassaras. We've got
the Cassara stuff, right?
Yeah.
So in February of 1976, Berkowitz moves to Jack and Nan Cassara's house in New Rochelle. Somebody's dates weren't solidified, but we can now by looking at these articles. Rena, why don't you read that there? Yeah.
Okay. Cassara knew Berkowitz as a relatively quiet tenant who had rented an upstairs room of his 174 Caligny Avenue home for $50 a week from February 18th to April 8th, 1976. In renting the room, Berkowitz expressed his dislike for dogs, and just 4 days before he left Caligny Avenue, he exploded over the barking of Cassara's two German shepherds. His ranting at 4 o'clock on a Sunday morning woke Jack and Nan Cassara. Jack followed his tenant, who stalked downstairs and out into the driveway, where he paced up and down, glaring at the dogs, cursing them, declaring, "The goddamn dogs, it's like a goddamn kennel." 4 days later, neither paying his $50 rent nor demanding the return of his $200 security, Berkowitz abruptly moved out.
Right. So you see there, February 18th, right, 1976, is the date he moved in Cassara's.
Yeah.
And April 8th is the last time they seen him. And if you heard the DA recording with Nan, that's the day he came over and picked up his last remaining stuff he had at the house. But if you look at this article, it talks about 4 days before how he had the problem with the dogs. We were never able to really pin this date down. But then if you look at it again, it says Sunday. So if you match these dates up, 1976, Sunday is April 4th. So April 4th, 1976 on a Sunday, 4 o'clock in the morning, was the day that Berkowitz had a problem at the Cassara house and left abruptly.
Yep.
Right.
So what we've got next is Nan Cassara said she rented Berkowitz a room in a New Rochelle house for $50 a week from February 18th to April 8th, 1976.
Right. That's just Nan. See, that's Nan's. Before was Jack's interview. That's Nan's now. Solidifying that February 18th date of getting in there.
So, photocopy of two-page lease application dated 3rd, 27th, 75, which is a mistake. It should say 76, bearing the hand printing and handwriting of David R. Berkowitz, which we'll go to next.
Right. This shows you that in March, on March 27th, there goes the application of 76. He was already planning on getting out of the Cassara house. Was trying to go to Pine Street. This was an application to get into 35 Pine Street.
So we got Jack Cassara's name on here, haven't we?
For reference, yeah.
Yep. So that's next one. So what have we got here, Neo?
That is April 1st now. The Pine Street building accepts him. So now he knows he's leaving the Cassara's on that date, April 1st. So as you can see, when
he's got nothing to lose,
right on the 4th, a couple days later from here now, when he does leave, it wasn't a spontaneous argument. He wasn't up there and just got sick. It looks and like
that's
he knew he was getting
this.
Out of there anyway, right?
Yeah, that's key to this. It wasn't spontaneous. He knew he was out of there.
Right.
So he had nothing to lose. So right. He could act how he wanted. So what we got next showing you is this. Sam Carr, we've got your man. Cassara said after learning the proximity of 35 Pine to Carr's home on Warburton Avenue. The Cassara investigation was completed and he had gone as Berkowitz hoped. In an interview late last year, Berkowitz was asked why he put Carr's name and return address on the card. He replied, simply, well, I wanted the police to come and find me.
Right. And that's all I could come up with that, too. I mean, he went mailing a bunch of letters and circling around him. And I really can't come up with any other reason he would have done that besides wanting to get caught. You know, so.
Yeah. Well, I think what we found here is key dates, basically. So we've got.
Right. Nothing nuts. You know, it was all there. But yeah, key dates.
The hole in the wall was created 16th of July, 1977. Not 2 days before the arrest.
Correct.
Not 1 day before the arrest.
Right.
Nearly a full month before the arrest.
Correct. Yeah. Now you got the date. There it is.
And we've got the dates for the Cassaras. Date he
right.
Was
the move-in date. We weren't too sure about the move-in date. We got that. We weren't too sure about the morning he had a problem with the Cassaras' dogs. We got that. All this is just good for the timeline. No crazy finding, but it's all good to just give out and plug in and so you can look at everything better.
It fills in the gaps in the timeline.
Right. Right. That's what it's all about, man. Get those gaps filled in so nobody could squeeze anything else in there. Facts in the gaps.
Facts in the gaps.
Right.
That's right, my friend.
Right.
Your input's always invaluable.
Yeah. Thanks for having me. And we're going to do a couple more things I see in the future. And
we've got
some live programs I think we're going to have soon. So I'm looking forward to all that. I got a book coming out about all these facts that everybody wants to see of David Berkowitz. I hope everybody enjoys it. And I'm looking forward to what's ahead. And
hopefully I can impress. The book is very good.
Thanks, Rena.
You know I've said that a bunch of times, but you know I mean.
Thanks. All right. We'll see each other soon.
All right, Neo.
Take care,
for helping me out.